Hello, everybody. Merry Christmas. Merry Christmas. Y'all can stand up. Thank you. Thank you for those Christmas greetings. It is our first Christmas service here at Redeemer Church. We are stoked and super nervous. But we just want you guys to enjoy worshiping with us today. I was thinking about how Jesus called the shepherds from their work. I mean, they just got right off of work and saw Jesus. So if you didn't come here all dressed up, you're okay. You're in a safe place. If you did, there were kings that came later and saw Jesus too. So we're welcoming both here today. Before we get started, let's pray. Lord, thank you. Thank you to be able to celebrate your birth. Thank you that you're here with us and that you're God with us. You're not far away, but you are close. And we just rely upon you today. We come to worship you, Jesus. And bless our service, Lord. I pray that you would be the center, that you would be the focus of what we're doing here today. We love you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Come and behold him.
because of our circumstances, but because of God with us, because you are with us, Lord. And we thank you that you give a joy unspeakable that surpasses what we can even understand. Thank you for anchoring our joy in the Savior. And Lord, if we are without him this morning, we pray that you would just turn our eyes to him. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. You all can have a seat.
Merry Christmas. We can do better than that, right? Merry Christmas. There we go. Gosh, we are so excited to celebrate the birth of our Savior with you this evening. How many of you have a favorite Christmas song? Raise your hand if you know what it is. So here's what I'm going to ask us to do, because this is Christmas and this should be a celebration, right? On the count of three, I want you to yell out the name, the title of your favorite Christmas song, okay? And look in judgment at other people who said a different song than you said, right? Here we go. One, two, three. Jingle Bells. She waited it out. I didn't know blah, blah, blah. It was a Christmas song, but that's awesome. We all have a favorite Christmas song, right? And if you were to ask my wife what my favorite Christmas song, she would unwaveringly tell you, what is it?
Oh, Holy Night.
Oh, Holy Night. Oh, Holy Night is my favorite Christmas song. Is that anybody else's favorite Christmas song? And the rest of you are wrong. It's okay. So, I love Oh, Holy Night. And the funny thing to me is that, as many of you know, and some of you don't, if you're new here, I grew up in a household of no believers. I didn't grow up as a follower of Jesus, and therefore Christmas was a time where I was excited about the presents. I was excited about the season, but I had no hope. And I didn't know the reason, and I surely didn't understand the reasoning behind Christmas songs. In fact, I had a music teacher by the name of Ann Barrett, who some of you know. She's actually still in this area leading music. And Ann was my music teacher as a freshman in high school. And I gave Ann a lot of silver hairs, even though you can't see them. I thought it was my job to tell Anne that we were not allowed to sing Christmas music. In fact, that went against, I don't know what I was thinking as a 13 or 14 year old, that went against the law and that she should be fired for trying to make us sing songs about Jesus. God's got a sense of humor, doesn't he?
Amen.
And amen. Can I just tell you something? For some of you, your story is very similar to that. Praise Jesus, that baby was born in that manger that ultimately became the salvation for your sin and mine. Even during that time when I didn't like Christmas music, I loved the song, Oh Holy Night. I had no idea why I loved it, but I was drawn to it. And for many of you, you have a song like that in your life that you would say, I'm drawn to. This is, it makes me focus upon the person of Jesus, and it causes me to focus upon the reason for the season, or it just makes me so doggone happy, right? And this evening, I thought to put a little different spin on a Christmas account. I've already preached 5 Christmas messages this year. How about you? And I wanted to share something a little different. So I thought we would, in context, look at the account of Jesus' birth from Luke chapter 2, but we would also look at the song, Oh Holy Night, and allow God to speak to us through that. Now, before we get into Luke chapter 2, and if you have a Bible, you're going to want to grab that. We'll be in Luke chapter 2. I am not going to put that up on the screen this evening. There will be some other scripture that I will, but I didn't want the people that put together our slides to kill me for 20 verses. And so I'm just going to read that out of God's Word. But if you have that, you're going to want to turn there. I want to give you a little context, a little background about the song, Oh Holy Night, how it came to be. It's an amazing story, and it makes the story even more wonderful when you realize how it came to us. In the 1850s, there was a guy by the name of Placide Capu, and he was a French wine merchant, and he was a poet, and he was very good at what he did. Placide was a wonderful poet, and he was renowned all around the area in which he lived, and a Roman Catholic priest came up to him one day, and he wanted him to write a poem about Luke chapter 2.
He wanted him to write a poem that would honor and glorify the birth of Jesus Christ, because this Roman Catholic priest was not a poet. He didn't have that gift of using words, and so he asked this Placide to go ahead and do that. Now, there was just one thing. Placide wasn't a believer. He wasn't a follower of Jesus. He was just a wine merchant and a poet. But because he liked to write and he had a great way with words, he actually wrote the words that we know now as the song, O Holy Night. Placide became so enthralled with what he had written that he had a friend that was, he was a music writer, and he said, could you help me put some music to this poem? And this writer did exactly that. The writer also, not a follower of Jesus, not a believer. And so what I believe to be the greatest Christmas song in the history of the world was written by two individuals that had no relationship with Jesus at all. But that song, upon writing the music for it and when it got out to the public, became an instant hit. And for about 3 years, it was played in all of the churches, both Roman Catholic and otherwise, all throughout the land. And then someone got wind that this song was written by someone who wasn't a follower of Jesus. And they said, ho, we can't allow someone who's not a follower of Jesus to write a song about Jesus, can we? How crazy is that? You know what, if God can cause a donkey to speak truth, he can use someone that doesn't have a relationship with Jesus, right? And so they tried to put a halt on the song, but it had become such a great hit that they couldn't stop it. About 60 years later, in 1906, there was a man by the name of Reginald Fessenden, and he was a 33-year-old Canadian professor. And he had invented this new type of electric generator. And he had an idea. And he took this new electric generator that he developed in his garage. And he hooked up a microphone to it. And he did what everyone else thought to previously be impossible. He began to crank the generator, and the microphone was recording. And for the first time in the history of the world, there was a broadcast over the airwaves. And in 1906, as Reginald Fessenden cranked that generator and the microphone picked up, here are the words that he shared. They're found in your Bibles in Luke chapter 2, beginning in verse 1. Reginald Fessenden spoke the gospel of Jesus Christ, about his birth and about his life. From Luke chapter 2, verses 1 through 20, here is what he said. In those days, a decree went out from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be registered. And this was the first registration when Quirinius was governor of Syria. And all people went to be registered, each to his own town. And Joseph also went up from Galilee, from the town of Nazareth, to Judea, to the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and the lineage of David. And he went to be registered with Mary, his betrothed, who was with child. And while they were there, there came time for her to give birth. And she gave birth to her firstborn son, and she wrapped him in swaddling cloths and lied him in a manger, because there was no room for him in the inn. And in the same region, there were shepherds out in the field, keeping watch over their flocks by night. And an angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them. And they were filled with great fear. Can you imagine? And the angel said to them, "Fear not, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. For unto you this day, in the city of David, a Savior has been born, who is Christ the Lord. And this will be a sign for you. You will find a baby swaddled in cloths and lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among those with whom he is pleased." And when the angels went away from them into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go into Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has made known to us." And they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the baby lying in a manger. And when they saw it, they made known the saying that had been told them concerning this child. And all who heard it wondered at what the shepherds told them. But Mary treasured up all of these things in her heart. And the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had seen and heard, as it had been told them. And as Reginald Fessenden spoke the words of Luke chapter 2, guess what song he played in the background of his recording? O Holy Night. The first words that ever went over the airwaves in a radio recording were scripture. And the first song that ever was played over the airwaves in the history of the world was a song detailing the glorious night that our Savior was born. O Holy Night. Now, I just want to be honest, I mean, because we have to really look at this account and realize that although it is a holy night, and the word holy simply means set apart, it means different, and this, of course, was a different night than any other night that had ever happened, because it was the night when God in the flesh came in the form of his Son to earth to be born, Emmanuel, God with us. This is a big deal. But a lot of times when we say, O Holy Night, we think about that night and that manger scene as a very peaceful, quiet time, right? How many of you ladies that have ever had birth think of that as a peaceful, quiet time? I just want to let you know that I believe that the manger scene that we see sometimes does us a disservice, doesn't it? Everyone's bowed, the cattle are lowing, whatever that means, right? The baby awakes, but little Lord Jesus, no crying he makes. Nonsense. Jesus cried all the time, even though he was God in the flesh. Absolutely, he cried. Because guess what? You can't have, let's just set the scene together, okay, folks? Because I think we have to realize that scripture says exactly what it means, but sometimes we have to use our brain to read between the lines. It was a holy night, but hear me very clearly. When you've got a teenage girl outside of wedlock given birth to a baby with no epidural in a cave, basically, surrounded by farm animals and things that farm animals do on the ground. Are we all speaking the same language? It was a holy night, but hear me, it was also, I believe, very chaotic. Jesus entered into this world in the way that he chose to come. Not as royalty that would be lauded, not as someone from a high palace that didn't have anything to do with the common people. He came to this world humble, even in his birth, as a servant, ultimately to give his life up as a ransom for many. And in the midst of his birth, there was chaos. God ordained chaos. Now, I remember when my son Jack was born. My wife, unlike me, if you know me, you probably know I'm not much of a planner, but my wife is a planner. And we had this all planned out. She knew exactly how it was going to go, when we were going to go to the hospital, how my son was going to be born. It was going to be a glorious time until she became 3 days overdue. And then it wasn't so much about glorious as it was, get this baby out of me. And she called me one day at the office, and she thought that maybe she had wet her pants. And I told her, maybe your water broke, and we realized that's probably what happened. And so we went to the hospital. And we went, and of course it was chaotic, and she went into labor, and labor progressed very slowly. And throughout that process, we thought that, you know, that's how you see it on the movies, right, most of the time. You just go in, and you're there for a few hours, and the baby pops out, and you smile, and you go home, right? That's how it works. Little did we know in our mid-20s that that was not the way this one was going to work. And so after about 10 hours of nothing happening at all, just labor, a nurse came in to check my wife, and I had, for the first time in those 10 hours, decided to leave my wife's side and go out to the waiting room and just tell her parents that it might be a little bit. And I came back in, and my wife's face was stark white. She looked like she'd seen a ghost. And I said, sweetheart, are you okay? And she said, the nurse just checked me, and the baby is breech and has had a bowel movement, and they have to take him now. And I said, okay. And evidently, I didn't understand how dire that was because I started to sit down and prepare for what was going to happen. And about that time, a nurse walked in. She took some scrubs and she threw them on my face. And she said, Dad, get ready. We're going now. And I said, okay. And I started to get ready, and they wheeled my wife off. And the things that ensued were anything other than peaceful. There were no cattle lowing. There was some chaos. And I was scared to death. And out of the midst of the chaos and the fear came one of the greatest joys of my entire life. And many of you mothers and fathers have been there. And even in their teenage years, when you don't remember how great it was a great day, right? The chaos of this night would have been overwhelming. And you say, why? Why are you focused on the chaos of it? Because I believe for many of you, you entered into this service this evening not coming from a peaceful, holy place, but coming from a weary world where there is chaos. I've got good news for you. God uses chaotic situations. He speaks truth into your life in the midst of your chaos. In fact, I want us this evening to focus on one portion of that song, O Holy Night. And there's a line in that song that says, a thrill of hope, the weary world rejoices. And that one word, weary, captures the mood of most people that I know. Would anyone here this evening, just by raising their hand, be willing to say, I feel weary? Anybody weary? Weary. The thrill of hope, a weary world rejoices. But yonder breaks a new and glorious morn. I want you to remember something this evening. Maybe you came in here and you are so overwhelmed by all of the things that are taking place, by the Christmas season, the things that have to be done, the gifts that didn't get wrapped, or the things that you couldn't take care of, or the fact that you feel like you're having to be surrounded by family that you don't know how to cope with, that you don't know how to talk to. You're doing all the things and trying to figure out how to have the right mood this holiday season. And I just want to let you know that in the midst of your weary world, a new and glorious morn is right on the horizon. Because that's what happens when Jesus shows up on the scene, as he makes all weary things brand new. In order to take a little journey with me this evening, we're going to venture out of the book of Luke, and we're going to go to the book of Jeremiah and look at a prophet who also at a time in his life became very weary. We're going to be looking at a book that you probably don't hear preached about much on Christmas, the book of Lamentations. That doesn't sound fun, does it? We're going to look at Lamentations chapter 3, and I want to give you some context before we read this. There was a prophet by the name of Jeremiah, and Lamentations is a book of lamenting. It is a book of Jeremiah crying out over the situation he's in. And the context is this, is that in 586 BC, the nation of Israel was captured by the nation of Babylon, the Babylonians, and they were taken into captivity. And of course, because the nation of Israel was captured, they were heartbroken. They didn't want to be in the situation they're in. You ever been in a situation you don't want to be in? You ever just sat down for a few moments on the couch or in your bed, maybe laid on the floor and kicked and screamed when no one could see you, or maybe you didn't care if they did, and just said, God, it's not fair. That's what's happening in the life of the prophet Jeremiah right now. He's crying out to God and he's telling him that it's not fair, that his heart is broken, that he doesn't know where else to go. And in Lamentations chapter 3, verses 20 through 26, here is what Jeremiah says. He says this, I well remember them, and my soul was downcast within me. Yet this I call to mind, and therefore I have hope. Because of the Lord's great love, we are not consumed, for his compassions never fail. Here's what he says about the Lord's compassions. They are new every morning. And he cries out to God, and in the midst of his hurting, he says, great is your faithfulness. I say to myself, the Lord is my portion. Therefore, I will wait for him. The Lord is good to those whose hope is in him, to the one who seeks him. And he makes this statement in verse 26. He says, it is good to wait quietly for the salvation of the Lord. And so maybe you're here this evening and you might say, with all of the chaos that's ensuing in my life, I wasn't able to purchase the gifts that I wanted to. I'm not able to keep up with the day-to-day struggles in life. My marriage is falling apart. The relationships around me are crumbling. I don't know my kids the way that I want to, or I learn things about my kids that I never wanted to know. They're struggling in school. I'm struggling in debt. I'm struggling in life. In this Christmas season, I just want to forget all of the problems. Well, can I tell you that in coming here this evening that I have great news, not just from a man's mouth, but from God's word.
Amen.
From God's word that is without error, that never fails, that communicates the true nature of God. Hear me very clearly. That God is in the business of making broken things new. It's what he does. And just as Jeremiah says, I will wait patiently on the Lord. I will wait patiently on him because his compassions never fail me. They are new every morning. My hope is in the Lord and the Lord alone. I'm here to tell you this evening that no matter what you're going through in life, even in the midst of this weary world, that Jesus came to this earth to be born in that manger to bring forth a new and glorious morn, to bring forth a new way of life, to bring forth salvation for those who think that they aren't worthwhile. And so I want to talk for a few minutes about what that new day in Jesus brings, this new and glorious morn. What does a new day with Jesus bring? Number one, it brings exactly what you need. You might be here this evening and you might be saying, Cole, I'm not exactly sure what I need. Well, I can tell you this, that a new day with Jesus brings exactly what you need. In Lamentations 3:24, as we just read, Jeremiah says, I say to myself, the Lord is my portion, therefore I will wait for him. What is he talking about when he says that the Lord is his portion? Many biblical scholars believe that Jeremiah is referring to manna. You guys remember what manna is? It's this heavenly bread that is sent to the Israelites when they are in the desert and they are starving. And they don't know where to turn and they can't provide for themselves. God, in his great grace and love for them, gives them that which they cannot do for themselves. He gives them food, not just food, heavenly food. And it's an amazing food. It supplies all of their needs. In fact, I'm sure at first it tasted really, really good. We know that later on, because the Israelites were totally unlike us, because we don't ever complain about what God gives us, right? They were totally unlike us, and they began to complain later on that the manna didn't have the right hot sauce with it, or, you know, all of those things. They complained about the manna. They said, this manna isn't very good, but here's what you need to remember about the manna. God said that he would provide that for them every single day, and he did. But what were they not allowed to do with the manna? Do you remember? They weren't allowed to store it up. They couldn't hoard it and put it in a special place. They couldn't make preparations for a time, now listen to this, when God failed to provide for them.
That's right.
They weren't allowed to do that. Because one of the things that God was teaching them was that he will never fail to provide for them. And I want you to know something this evening, that God will never fail to provide for you. Even when the depth of your sin is so deep that there's no way you can dig your way out of it. There's no way that you can pay for it. There's no way that you can make up for it. God says, you talk about manna, I've got the only thing you need. And that person is Jesus, and I will send him to this earth so that you might have new life in Christ. Can I ask you something? Is it okay, church, if we get excited about Jesus on Christmas Eve? I think so many times we're so focused on all the things that we have to do that we miss out on the one thing that had to be done. And that one thing changed everything. And in that moment, God gave us exactly what we needed. That chaotic, holy night. Jesus Christ was born. He's what your marriage needs. He's what your kids need. If you are weak, Jesus is your strength. If you are lost, Jesus is your way. If you are hurting, Jesus is your comfort. If you are down, Jesus is your joy. Jesus Christ came to make all things new. Jesus gives you exactly what you need. Number two, the second thing that a new day with Christ brings is the hope to keep going. And you might say, well, I don't know that I need the hope to keep going. I can assure you, if you don't need it now, there will come a time where you do. And I believe that for some of you here, you were invited by someone. Maybe you walked in off the street, and the only thing you need to hear right now is a word of hope. And I'm telling you, I've got all kinds of words of hope, because God's word is full of hope for those who need hope. The thrill of hope, the weary world rejoices. In Lamentations 3:25, like we read, Jeremiah said this: the Lord is good to those whose hope is in him, the one who seeks him. It has been said that you can live around 40 days without food, that you can live around 8 days without water, that you can live a little over 4 to 5 minutes without oxygen, but that you can only live a few seconds without hope. Hope is something that we all need. We all need something to cling to when we don't have it figured out. And some of you have learned over the years that if you hope in the stock market, that the stock market will fail you. That if you hope in your company, that your company will lay you off. That if you hope in a certain person, that that person will let you down. But that if you hope in an outcome, the outcome won't turn out the way that you want it to. Your hope cannot be in the things of this world. Your hope has to be in the person of Jesus Christ, who makes all things new, who makes your brokenness restoration, who brings your salvation, and says, I gave up my life for you. In fact, in the book of Hebrews, in chapter 10, verse 23, the writer of Hebrews says this. He says, let us hold unswervingly to the hope that we profess. For he who promised, can we all say it together? For he who promised is faithful. He is faithful. The one who promised is faithful. Faithful. We need to have the hope to keep going, you and I, and that hope is found in the person of Jesus. The third thing that Jesus brings, a new day with Jesus, the third thing that it brings is it brings the help that you are seeking. Lamentations 3:26, Jeremiah said this, it is good to wait quietly for the salvation of the Lord. Can I ask you something? If you're in this room and there's come a point in your life where you have surrendered your life to Jesus, where you have traded in your life for the new life that he gives, if you have laid down your life at the foot of the cross and said, Lord Jesus, take away my sin, make me a brand new person. For those of you that have found the help that you're seeking in Jesus, isn't it amazing the difference that one day can make? Amen. I remember, as I said, I grew up as a non-believer, and I can remember the night before the day I gave my life to Jesus. And I had gone out with some friends, and we were hanging out, and we were doing what teenagers do. We were partying, and we were drinking, and we were carrying on, and I remember that I was doing all the things that teenage boys do. I was trying to hook up with girls, and I was trying to look cool in front of other people, and I was trying to be the man of the hour and the big guy and all those things. I can remember doing some crazy stuff that we probably don't need to talk about at Christmas Eve at church. And you ever been there? I remember I'd been going to church with a friend for about a month and a half at that point, and I knew that I was supposed to go to church with him the next day, but I was having a whole lot of fun that night, and I had had quite a bit to drink already, and I just really didn't want to leave, and I didn't want to get up, so I can remember sitting there thinking of all the excuses as to why I was going to call him and tell him that I couldn't show up, and I, for some reason, I just couldn't come up with one.
Think about all the excuses that you could come up with to get out of church, right? You've done them before, right? There's a good football game on. I don't feel good. I need to stay home. There's a million things you could have said, especially as a teenage boy. I don't want to go. Leave me alone, right? Could have said anything. I couldn't come up with anything at all. I literally remember trying to come up with an excuse as to why I couldn't go to church. I couldn't come up with one. And that next morning I got up, and I think I was a little hungover, and he took me to church. And I remember going, and I remember thinking about all the things that I did the night before, and I remember thinking I didn't want to be there. And I remember sitting during the sermon and listening to the pastor speak, and I'm just going to be honest with you, the words that he said, they had no impact on my life. I really could care less. I didn't want to hear them. I just wanted to go home, and I just wanted to be the same old Cole that I had been. And then he started talking about Jesus. He started talking about how the rebellion in my life, the times when I chose to do it my way rather than God's way, that those things were called sin, and that the only cure for my sin, the only way to take away my sin, was to surrender my life to Jesus. And I can remember sitting there thinking, quit talking about Jesus. I don't want to hear any more about Jesus. But the more he talked about Jesus, the more I was enthralled with Jesus. Amen. You ever been there? Amen. And I felt like he was speaking directly to me. You ever been there? Amen. And I remember I kept thinking, quit looking at me. He wasn't looking at me. He was like 100 years old. He couldn't even see me, right? I have no idea. And he told me about the love of Jesus. He told me about how I, as a broken, sinful, rebellious teenager, would stand before a holy God one day and have to answer for all of the decisions that I'd made in life, and that God might even ask me the question, why should I let you into my heaven? And I remember struggling under the weight of that question. I remember struggling with what I would say to God, how I would answer that, because I knew there's no way that I could ever say it, because I've been good enough, because I've been nice enough, because I earned it, because I deserve it. I knew those answers didn't play out. And the more he talked, and the more I realized that everywhere he went in this book, it all just pointed back to Jesus. And I realized that really the decision I had to make was not, was I going to become a member of the church? Not was I going to look like all the kids that were sitting with me at the time. It was, what was I going to do with Jesus? Because according to what this book said, this Jesus that was born in that manger, he lived a perfect life without sin. And he gave up his life for me, to pay the penalty of the weight of sin that I could not pay. There was no way that I could die and pay that penalty. Only Jesus could. And that if I would surrender my life to him, that he would give me brand new life. It gives a whole new meaning to that manger, doesn't it? It gives a whole new meaning to a song that we sing at Christmas. Because that day, less than 24 hours after I had been just living it up and dead in my sin, that next morning, for the first time, I heard the truth of Jesus in a way that I could understand. And I bowed my knee and my heart that day to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And I asked Jesus to come into my life and take away my sin and make me a brand new person. Because you see, when Jesus shows up, he changes everything. And when Jesus shows up, it's amazing the difference that a new day makes. And for some of you, you know what you need? You need a new day.
You need a new day in Jesus. For some of you, if I asked you to tell your story right now, you could go on for days and weeks about all the bad decisions you've made and all the brokenness that is there and all the hurt and the pain that you have or even that you've caused. And you could tell me why you don't measure up. And you could tell me why you can never be useful to God. And you could tell me why there's no way that Jesus is enough to take away that kind of sin. And I'm here to tell you that's what he does. He takes away sin and he makes things brand new. I want to remind you of a couple things. There was a guy by the name of Lazarus that we read about in the New Testament. And in fact, we find out that Lazarus, at the point where Jesus comes on the scene, had been dead for 4 days. In fact, I believe the King James Version says it best when it literally says, he stinketh. He had been dead for a long time. There was no hope. He was beginning to smell. They didn't know what to do with him. And Jesus comes on the scene and he says, brother, get up. Get up. And before the end of those 4 days, Lazarus was just dead. There was no more life. And Jesus comes on the scene and guess what? That day, everything was made new. Scripture tells us about a woman that was bleeding. She was bleeding for 12 years. Can you imagine the embarrassment and the pain and the heartache that it caused her everywhere she went, that people thought she was unclean and she couldn't be out among people every day? And she was so desperate, no one could do anything for her. And scripture tells us that this woman that had been bleeding for over a decade, for 12 years, she goes and she's so desperate to have her condition healed that she just reaches out to touch the hem of the garment of Jesus. And scripture tells us that when she does, she's healed. For 12 years, no one could do anything for her. And on a brand new day with Jesus, everything changed. She was made whole, and she was made clean, and she was made pure. It's a guy that sat by the pool for 38 years lame. He couldn't walk. He was an invalid. 38 years. No hope. And one day, Jesus shows up on the scene. And he says, get up, pick up your mat, and walk. And on that day, when Jesus showed up, he changed everything. And he made him brand new. You see, all throughout the context of history, because this baby came in Luke chapter 2, because Jesus is God with us, the only one who has the power over sin and death, the only one who is able to do the miraculous in our life, the only one who is able to take the chaos of our weary world and make it brand new, that Jesus, the same Jesus who changed everything in a heartbeat in Scripture, is the same Jesus that's in this room tonight.
Amen.
And his question for you is this. Because I was born, because I lived, and ultimately because I died, what will you do with me? Will you allow me to change you? Will you allow me to transform you? Will you finally surrender? Man, I've got some good news. I'm going to try not to get too fired up here. The Apostle Paul, in speaking to the church in Rome, in Romans chapter 13, he just wanted to let them know what time of day it was, right? He just wanted to let them know what the situation looked like. And in Romans chapter 13, verses 11 and 12, here's what Paul said to the church in Rome. He said this, the hour has come for you to wake up from your slumber. Because our salvation is nearer now than when you first believed. The night is nearly over and the day is almost here. Let us awaken. And that's what Paul said to the church in Rome. And I believe if Paul were here, he would say the same thing to you. You might wonder, wow, this doesn't sound much like a Christmas message. I got news for you. This is the only reason there is a Christmas message. This is it. There is no other reason. And guess what? We had church yesterday, and we talked about the exact same thing. Totally different scripture, totally same Jesus, who's still in the business of changing lives, who's still in the business of saving souls. And at the end of service, we had people bow their knees and give their life and heart to Jesus. And tonight, I believe that there's people who came into this room, and you came to hear a sweet sermon about a baby in a manger. Guess what? He's not a baby, and he's not in a manger. He is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, and he is seated at the right hand of the Father. Even now, he's there, and that's why we celebrate him, and that's why we gather together, and that's why this holiday is so beautiful. But for us to show up this evening and just give you a love of a sweet Christmas story, oh my gosh. You do realize there's people that only show up to church twice a year, and for some of you, this is one of yours. And listen, there's no judgment in that statement. I love you. I am so glad you're here. But I have to be able to look you in the eye and tell you that there is one thing that you need to know more than anything else. And that is this, that you have a problem, and it's the same problem that we all have. And that problem is called sin. And it is simply rebellion against God. It's choosing to do things your way instead of God's way. And we don't have to raise our hands. We all know we're a part of that. And God, because he is so holy and so just, he can have no relationship with sin. And so what did he do? He sent his son from the realm of heaven to come to earth to be born. Not just to be born, but to be born in the craziest of ways. To leave heaven as a king and to come to earth and be born as in a cave beside barnyard animals. In order to let you know that he came for all people, not just the rich ones that have it all together. That baby lived a perfect life so that he could ultimately give up his life for you. And this Christmas, out of all of the things that you have to do, out of all of the gifts that you will give, and oh my gosh, out of all the amazing things that you will receive, there is one thing that each of you needs to know more than anything else. That there is one way to have a relationship with God. There is one way to have your sins forgiven. And that way is through Jesus Christ. And that if you would confess to him that you are a sinner and ask him to take away your sin, to make you brand new, if you would surrender your life to that Jesus, that he will do just that. He will make you brand new. I made that decision over 21 years ago, and it's still the greatest decision I ever made. And I just want to let you know something. That's the reason why O Holy Night is my favorite Christmas song now. Because when we start singing about my dear Savior's birth, it means something. Because he did that which I cannot, and he did that which you cannot, and he is simply waiting for you to finally get over all the excuses, to get past all the reasons why you don't trust him, to simply come to him and say, Jesus, I need you. Save me. Make me brand new. You talk about the greatest Christmas ever. Give your life to Jesus and see if God doesn't change your life in an amazing way. So today, I have great news for you. A child has been born, and he is Christ the Lord. And he came to be the Savior of the world and to take on your sin, to be your substitute, to pay your price. And that baby, over 2,000 years ago, ultimately gave his life and died for you and I. But I've got good news for you. They may have rolled a stone over the door of his tomb, but 3 days later, he wasn't there any longer. He is risen and seated at the right hand of the Father. He is victorious over sin and death. He is victorious over the chaos and the weariness of your world. And he so desperately wants to do something amazing in your life. So today, as we sing songs celebrating the birth of our Savior, some of you simply need to cry out to God and say thank you, because you are a born-again follower of Jesus and you do have that truth in your life. But some of you, today is the day of salvation. Today is the day where you make things right with God and surrender your life to Jesus. Today is the day where you hand it all over. And if that's you, I'm going to be in the back in a second. You can come talk to me. We've got counselors in the back. They would love to talk to you. There is no greater thing than we'd love to be able to do with you this evening than to offer you the hope that only Jesus can bring. And maybe you're here and you'd say, that's not what I need, but I'm hurting this Christmas season and I just need someone to hug me. I just need someone to love me. I just need someone to pray with me and tell me it's going to be okay. Oh my gosh, if you come to the right place, we would love to do that because there is great hope and peace and joy found in Jesus and Jesus alone. So here's what we're going to do. We're going to pray and then we're going to sing. And I pray that you won't leave this place without doing business with the Lord. Would you pray with me? Father, we are so thankful for your word, and we are thankful for the new day that you bring. And we are thankful that our salvation is found in Christ and Christ alone. And so this evening we say, God, thank you. Thank you for sending your son. Thank you for taking away our sin. Father, thank you for giving us new life. Father, might all the words that we sing this evening bring you glory. It's in the powerful saving name of Jesus we pray. Amen.
Stand up with us.
Sin and error.
Christmas, you all. Thank you for joining us, and hope you have a Merry Christmas.
Thanks.